visual support also. Well, basically what I'm going to show you is a work in progress. This has been done at the University of Delft, and we are looking into the development dynamics over time of FreeBSD. Let me start from the very basic things. I understand that all of you know what free software is. Something that you can use, modify, and redistribute. This project started in 1993. It's characteristic that it all started when a project split into two projects as a result of the frustration of developers with the pace at which the project incorporated patches. So basically, you have one project, 386 BSD, which forked into two more projects. One of these is FreeBSD, and to this day it's considered the most successful BSD descendant, meaning it's been used by companies to run systems in critical mission deployments. Still not that good, huh? What we will show you in specific is the results of data mining the CVS of FreeBSD since 1994. So we've looked into 14 years of development.
Last speaker had the same problem.
I had the same problem.
So how did you cope with this? It's all right, huh? Well, it's not really, it's not all right.
No.
Yeah, because plenty of detail is lost. There must be a way to walk around through it somehow. Or we could use the small slides if everything else doesn't work, yeah. Yeah, should work. Nice. Can we go to the next? How? yeah. That seems to work. So, yeah, that slide, please go to slide 3, more or less describes in a very summary fashion the past of FreeBSD, that it all started in the 60s, then we have this key personality, Bill Joy, and in the process of all this legal conflict between two entities, we get FreeBSD as a result of developers' frustration, like we said, at the pace with which the project incorporated patches. So if something doesn't work the way you like it, you can always fork it. This is the key freedom protected, given by free software. By looking more specifically into the development dynamics, could you please go to the next slide? We see that there are people developing FreeBSD everywhere. It's a global thing, international. However, if we look at their production output measured in lines of code, we see that development is most heavily concentrated in Europe and Americas. If we look at how old those people are, we see various ages ranging from 20 to 60. However, most of them fall within the 25-40 region. Please, next slide. The next slide more or less describes the organizational structure of the project, which is to a large extent inherited from BSD. BSD is sometimes credited for codifying an organizational template for what is nowadays called the open source development model. So, in short, this means that you have a core people, a small group of people having the right to make and change things in the code base. Radiating around them, we have a larger number of people called committers. Oh, I made a mistake here. So let me take it from the beginning. It's a small digression. This project, when they started, you understand, was much smaller. So you had a small number of people, more or less coordinating among themselves. However, in the process of time, as more people got into the project, they realized they needed a new model. So they proceeded to an elective model, meaning that every 2 years, those people who are actively contributing get together and they vote for those who are gonna be the core team. According to the current bylaws of the project, those people are about a dozen. And what those people can and they do, aside from developing code, so those people are not really managers, they're developing code, is to grant or revoke privileges to the code base. So in other words, how you start participating in the project is by being a contributor. In 2003, there were an average of 5,000 people contributing to the project. Those people contribute either by sending bug reports or patches to the people who have the right to incorporate that code into the code base. So they send their stuff to those people who are the only ones who have the right, the privilege, to commit those changes to the code base. And those people get their privileges or have them revoked by the people in the core center. Could you go to the next? This is a more formalized view of the structure of FreeBSD. In this case, the arrows, of course, do not indicate some authority relation, meaning that the people at the boxes on the top cannot command the people in the boxes at the bottom. So this does not signify an authority relation, the ability to command somebody's labor. However, what we see is a multitude of teams catering for a multitude of different purposes, from marketing and soliciting fundings. We have how many teams? I think there are more than 30 teams nowadays. Among them, the most important ones, aside from the core team over here at the top, is the release engineering team, which should be, I think, this. It's not very visible. This team is very important because they have the right to decide what gets into the product in those times when, let me slightly rephrase it to make the point more obvious. Those people are what I would call dictators. So at certain times in the development of FreeBSD, they are the ones granted the right to decide what gets into the code base or not. We'll elucidate this point a bit further on. Could you go to the next slide, please? Hopefully that's gonna be better clarified through this slide. So the development process usually starts with a person having written some code. Initially, they have to ask for community feedback, meaning that they send an email to a list saying, I've written this and I want somebody to review it. Typically, this generates a feedback in, two or three people getting back to you saying this works or not. Following this step, usually they test the code they've written locally in their own systems and provided, assuming these builds, then they commit it to the development branch of the project, which is called, in our case, current. It's also known as trunk or as the head branch. In our presentation, we use all terms synonymously, but we mostly refer to the development branch as current. So once the code is in the current branch, there is a development release made twice a day. They use those Tinder boxes for this reason. So every day there are two development releases of FreeBSD. Those releases are being downloaded, tested, and debugged much more massively, of course, than would otherwise be the case. Following this step, the initial code is being merged from the current branch into the stable branch, which is not the experimental branch. It's the one aimed at people who want something safe, something without too many bugs. And that's why this process is often known as MFC, merged from current. Following this step, there comes the role of the dictator, the release engineering team. This process is called code slash, which means that whenever the project decides that development is in a code slash, only corrective changes can be added to the code, meaning only bug fixes can be incorporated in the code base. Following this period, we have the code freeze, which again is the period through which the release engineering team has full authority to control what goes into the code. And usually in this period, they accept no changes at all, and they only try to iron out some glitches so as to have a fully performing release. This gives a new release, in average, every 3 months. And you understand that since most developers in FreeBSD work as individuals, this model, this is being used in parallel by many more developers. In FreeBSD, they like to call it, they have this nice term, heavily branched. Let me see. I really like it, it's hard to pronounce. Heavily branched development model, occurring independently. The next slide, please. So like I showed you, this leads to a new release every 3 months. Next slide, please. And now let's get more specific into the development dynamics. We first present the conclusions, what we've found, which is, first of all, something that is emerging. It's not imposed from the top, but comes from the bottom. In that sense, it's not division of labor affected by managers, but a division of labor that is premised on the self-selection of tasks by participants. If we see that some participants contribute less than others, this does not have to do with being forced to contribute less. We believe that the motivation argument, the motivation ability argument, more correctly, which basically means that you contribute to the best of your motivation and to the best of your abilities, fully explains what's happening here. Let's get into the actual slides. Yeah. And now I'm going to pass the slides on to Ludo, who will take you through the division of labor.
I get back to where I was. Yeah. So we analyzed the CVS repository, specifically the current branch of FreeBSD, to see how this labor was divided between the people working on the project. Yeah, these are just raw numbers, not very interesting. There's about 300 people in total that have worked on it over the years. And you see that there, over the years, as the project grew larger, there was also more and more committers joining, which seems to have stabilized around 3 or 4 years ago. It seems as if programming on FreeBSD is quite addictive, because a lot of committers join over the years, but they rarely leave. So it's apparent that there is a strong attachment of the committers towards the project. As they enter, they keep on working on the project for years. Yes?
Committers automatically get removed if they become committed?
Yeah, I've only measured active committers, so those committers who contributed code on that year.
Wacht even.
Hi. Well, it's done by hand. The accounts are removed by hand. There's a script that's run on one of the systems that checks how long the latest commit of that user was. And sometimes it's often forgotten, but like once a year or once every 2 years, someone steps up and sees if people are still alive. For average, that's okay.
Yeah, what we did here to quantify productivity is to look at the amount of CVS commits a certain individual has produced every year. So if these numbers represent each developer that has at least put one commit into the CVS repository over that year. And here you see we made a distinction because it's quite nice in the CVS repository. Every commit that specifically deals with fixing a bug as an annotation called PR, referring to the number in the bug tracking system. We can see that, Jesus, man, this is small. yeah, that's both. So the green line is the people that produce only new code. And the red line is the amount of people that produce both code and fix bugs. And there's a very small group of, on the blue line there, of people that specialize merely in bug fixing. We assumed at first that there would be an introductory process towards FreeBSD, that you start with bug fixing and then you move on into doing other stuff. But apparently there's only a very little group who stays to fixing bugs solely. This gets a little more interesting if you look at it as percentages of total. You see over the years, it starts off with a very high focus on producing new code. Of course, the small code base in 93 was rather small. But then around 99 to 2003, it's like this period, suddenly there's a big focus on fixing bugs and cleaning up the whole code base. We'll see that further on in the presentation coming back in some other graphs, that that period of time was essential in FreeBSD production process to clear up the whole code base and get on from there. Mm-hmm. What you can see here is the red line is the
1,000 lines of code.
It's, yeah, 1,000 lines of code. The blue line is the amount of modules within the FreeBSD project. And the green line, I believe, to be the amount of megabytes.
Megabytes,
yeah. And the green line,
Must be megabytes.
Yeah. The other I can't actually read, but...
yes.
Yeah. Anyway, it's, as you see, the amount of modules increases quite coherently with the general size of the code base. So as more and more code is being programmed also, it's being put into more and more different modules. This is a bit of a clearer graph on how the code base grew in terms of kilobytes over the years. And this core group of top 15 committers over the years produced a smaller and smaller percentage of the entire code base. The big group of people around it became more significantly important in the creation of the software. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Speak up.
It seems that that development of the top 15 getting less important, it's slowed down.
Yes.
Do you have any explanation for that?
Well, as the top 15 committers, as more and more committers join, the top 15 committers become a smaller part of the total. Yeah.
Ah.
Yeah. Here we see the division of labor plotted out for the entire FreeBSD project from starting in 93 up till 1st of January 2008. This line here represents the bug fixes, and the others are the new code and the total amount of commits. These are the number of committers it took, some percentages, and these are the commits. As you can see, 20% of the people did about 80% of the work. So it's still a core group that's working really hard, but those top 15 compared to the rest simply become a smaller and smaller percentage. You can also see this developing over the years. This goes from year to year to year. And as you can see, it stays quite stable. The bug fixes are a bit more widespread throughout the entire group of people that are working on the project. But implementing new functionality definitely stays on this 20-80 line where, yeah, 20% of the people do 80% of the work. Yeah, of course, as more and more, as the project grows, you need more people to work on it.
Although they always remain at 20% more or less of the committer space. So the number of people might be more, might be increasing, but still in percentage, it's the same. Is that answering your question before? Because you pointed out, well, you see that the top 15 are increasingly less important in development. Didn't you ask that? So the contribution of the top 15 of the most productive committers falls over time. That's what we see in the slide.
Or stops falling.
True. True. In the end, it seems to stabilize. Kind of stabilize. Yeah. It's hard to say.
These top 15 do, yeah.
And I think now it's my turn, eh?
Yeah, this.
Nice. So let me get the next slide. Now we are going to look into productivity specific measures. What we see here is the amount of changes committed to the code base per year over time. What we see is it rises up to year 2006 and then it starts to decline. However, by looking at the same thing slightly differently in terms of lines of code or kilobytes added to the code base, we see in the end that they rise. Similarly with lines of code, which means that although the number of code contributions goes down, their average size measured in kilobytes or lines of code goes up. Next slide, please. However, if we look at average production output relative to the number of people who comprise the committer space, we see that as the number of people increase, average productivity goes down. This, of course, is reminiscent of Brooks' law, so we would like to look a little bit more into it. Let's go to the next slide. So what we did is we compared the code contributions made by the top 15 committers versus the whole project. So the blue line is the top 15 and the rest is the whole project. What we see is that under no circumstances could one say that their output is being affected negatively by the increase of the committer space. More or less they move in the same directions as if they follow the same greater development dynamic. So if average productivity goes down, that is not because core developers produce less, are less productive, but rather because the disproportionate increase of, say, low contribution participants. So this begs a new question. How is this possible, since the number of people has kept on increasing, and therefore, as by extension, the coordination costs increase? How is that possible? We speculate at this point that this is because those core people contribute more time and effort in the course of their engagement with the project. So you start 1 year, the second year you are even more motivated. So that's what we believe, that those people over time increase their participation in the project.
Hi, have you looked at Perforce?
Not as much as I would like. This is CVS data, so we haven't used Perforce to analyze.
What I've heard is that an explanation for the lower number of CVS commits is that people committed to Perforce first and give it more testing there, and then less commits are needed to bring the functionality into CVS or subversion.
I had no idea. Thanks a lot for the comment. It Yeah, that could explain it fairly well.
So, for example, last year I worked on replacing the TTY code for FreeBSD, and I worked in a perforce branch for like half a year or so, and then I committed it to to SVN that time in one single commit, which was enormous because it was like a change of, well, I'd say 12,000, 15,000 lines of code, and that in a single SVN commit. So nowadays the commits are so big compared to the old days, where in the old days it was just replacing line by line and hoping that it didn't break anything alongside. So
we are going to need those two guys, Ludo.
So, well, basically right now it is that the quality of the code is likely to improve because head is not broken for a very long time because it's first tested in perforce.
But you say this has become the norm in FreeBSD development, that these days most of the development work goes first into perforce and then is merged into the CVS. Sorry. I will catch up on that later. Eh? So, next slide. A little bit more data on what happens with ownership of modules, of the subparts in which the software is decomposed. What we basically would like to stress is that a large number of modules do not have a specific maintainer, do not have an owner associated with them. So a good percentage, almost half of them, are being developed in a jointly developed, how may I put it? They do not belong to anybody. There is this notion that a module belongs to a person who's responsible for that. What we see here is that almost half of the modules cannot be explained by this notion. They are being developed jointly by a number of different individuals who assume collectively responsibility for the module. Next one, we see the same as regards files. So we see a large number of files with only one committer, as if they belonged to that person. But we also see a great number of files being developed by more than 9 people. So the comment responsibility in this case, like I said, should not be confused with something implying exclusive rights. It's highly collaborative. That's what we'd like to stress. Next slide, please. This is even more obvious if we look at the composition of the core developers group over time. So over time, we see that, meaning in 30 years, of those 60 people who comprise the most productive developers, there is only one with 13 years in the group, one with 11, one with 10, and the average is 3.5 years, which basically means that the composition of the group itself, is being renewed, is being recycled internally. Let's see the graphs also, they're quite fancy. We see this here graphically depicted. So over time, we see, for instance, that there is one developer having contributed so much more than others on this year, but his contribution the next year plummets, whereas another person contributes much more than the year before. So the conclusion that comes out of this, is that the project does not depend on a specific set of individuals. It has the ability to regenerate itself as time goes by with new people contributing, substituting for those who contributed in the past, and so on. So in this sense, the project regenerates itself. It's not dependent on a code god. And now I'm going to pass the presentation again on to Ludo. Is that the time? To tell you more specifically about modularity in the project, the role of modularity.
Well, ever since the 70s in IBM, basically, there was the notion that you can't simply throw more people at a software project to increase productivity. And as more and more people start working on the same code, it just ran into one big mess. And the classical way to circumvent this was by modularity, and we're curious to see if that also applies in open source software. So that first brings us to the question of how to quantify modularity. And as an example, let's have a look at this small little code base. What we did was look and trace all the function calls from one file to another within FreeBSD. So assume you have a little bit of code where you have file A calling a function in file B, calling a function in file D, and A calling in C, calling E, calling F, etc. Then if you put this all into a matrix, the design structure matrix, as they neatly call it, first step, well, every file, of course, depends on itself. Then it has some explicit dependencies. So A depended on B and C and on nothing else, etc. But since B also depended on D, I believe, B was D, yeah. So implicitly, A also depends on D. And you keep tracing all these dependencies until you have a fully filled matrix where you can look at the percentage of binary ones versus zeros, and you have some kind of a quantification of how complex and how modular this code is. The higher this number, the more internal dependencies are spread throughout the entire code base.
The percentage of files that are likely to change whenever a change is done to any one file in the code base.
Pretty much. So I was having a nice time with C-scope and traced all the function calls throughout the FreeBSD over the years and calculate this propagation cost. We would have expected the code base to become more modular over time as the code base grew and grew and grew. However, what we see is, again, in this period from 99 to around 2003, they did a good job at cleaning up the code base. But after that, the complexity just rises really high again. So in contradiction to what you would normally expect from Brooke's law, there doesn't seem to be a very high increase of modularity over the years. However, then...
Well, just a quick comment, which is that I argue that your approach here may be a little bit flawed, because anytime you reuse code in this measurement, then you're increasing your dependency count there. And code reuse is a classical way to reduce... Oh, okay, sorry, go on.
I'm going into this right now. This was the classical way of quantifying modularity, really. We acknowledge that this is not a very fair way of looking at modules. What seemed more important is the amount of external dependencies every module has. As you see, this rises over the year, but this rises synchronously with the increase of the code base and the increase in the amount of modules. So if you look at the average, the amount of external dependencies for each module per line of code and per kilobyte, and most importantly, per module, you see that there wasn't a big increase in the beginning, of course, but then already very early in the project, this has stabilized to about 50 external function calls from each module on the average. So this is pretty much the state our research is in at the moment. We have still to solve the question of how to properly quantify modularity and whether or not FreeBSD completely negates Brooke's law or not. But that was pretty much the end of it. Any questions?
I have a question. So I guess this is still ongoing work, you say? So what's the expected output? Do you plan on coming up with some recommendations to the FreeBSD team, FreeBSD developers, or what?
Definitely. Well, it's a research project conducted by the UDEV. So the object of this research is to basically understand development and scale, the interplay between things getting bigger, more people participating, and what comes out of this collective effort. Certainly, as you also, there are still some things that we need to look into. Some interviews to be done with FreeBSD developers. Perhaps some things that we could, like you say, maybe something really practical could come out of this, which could be of use for developers themselves also. Maybe some things they haven't noticed. Maybe some tools they could employ to facilitate their own work.
Right.
What do you have in mind? What could you see coming out of this project that could potentially be of use to FreeBSD developers themselves?
Well, I can see, I mean, looking at the last few slides here, you could perhaps look for potential problem areas by defining some metrics. So say, okay, we're gonna run this static analysis on a module and say, this module has a lot of dependencies, therefore maybe you want to think about decomposing it and this kind of thing. So I can see ways to help scaling the project that way. And I also have another question, which I'm stealing the microphone, I know, but what about other BSDs or other projects? Do you think you're going to be able to use the similar techniques to, say, look at the NetBSD code base? Or that's my last question.
Well, I haven't thought about that. Initially, we thought of comparing what we find to OpenOffice and XNU to basically contrast it with something developed within a proprietary mode of development. But to our disappointment, neither Apple nor Sun are really keen on providing us with what we need. So perhaps we are going to come down to comparing this to other free operating systems. So could be NetBSD perhaps, Linux.
Yeah, I wrote some rather awkward tools, mostly Perl and C, to do the analysis on this whole code base. Basically, any project that's done in CVS and works with C code, plain C, preferably kernel projects, since then there's no external libraries and other stuff to take care of, which helps a lot in tracing dependencies. It's fairly easy to do comparative research on that.
If your code base is not on CVS, but for instance, a version or maybe even a bit?
I was starting to look into Git and then got a bit of a headache. But yes, a version should be minor problem. Basically, what I did is take the entire CVS repository and slam it into MySQL and then query it from there. Do the same with SVN.
Where live all those working people? In the USA?
Come again?
All these people, they are working on this program. Where do they live?
Where?
The USA?
Oh, we had an interesting slide about that. No. That's all the way at the beginning somewhere. Let's see. Here.
Yeah, you can see there's a main focus on Europe and the US, but it's pretty international, I would say.
Is there also data available on the contribution of paid people versus the people who are not paid to develop?
No, because quite fairly, I don't know who is being paid and who's not. We could ask everyone, but
It was in 2007, so in short they said, well, 50% of the people are getting paid to do what they do, whereas the other 50 do not, meaning the committers. However, most of those people had started contributing way before they started getting paid for that, so their motivation cannot be explained by means of those green tickets. It's just they found a way to make their hobby more sustainable, if I may put it like this. But yeah, nowadays 50% of those people are remunerated in some way, either directly or indirectly. They're either freelancers or some company employs them to develop what they do.
So Some people are paid to get them alive, to keep them alive. Like Paul Henningkamp is running projects for the project. They are that important that he makes time available for that, and then he gets paid from FreeBSD Foundation or something like that. So it's happening more often.
Should we call it a day then?
I would like Ludo and George and you to thank them for their talk, and you can ask personal questions later, not too personal.